Bristow by Frank Dickens, with Michael Williams as Bristow, Rodney Bewes as Jones, Owen Brenman as Hewitt, and Dora Bryan as Mrs Purdy. Fair shares.
You know my trouble? I'm unlucky. I was born with rubbish genes. Not exactly rubbish genes, but the wrong genes. I inherited the genes on my father's side. Genes not of this century. I would have probably made a name for myself if they were still laying siege to castles, because my great-great-great-grandfather was one of those soldiers that attached stones or boiling cauldrons to giant catapults. He was eventually, according to family records, hoist by his own petard. But that's another story. Since I work as a buying clerk in a big organization, it would have helped me more had I been born with my mother's genes, because her side of the family were in business. Merchants handling spices and perfumes and silks from faraway places with strange-sounding names. Not that my mother's ancestors were traders themselves. According to the family records, they were domestics in the Marco Polo family, but there is no doubt they would have been familiar with stocks and shares, knowledge picked up in the conversation over dinner as they were serving the guests their exotic meals. And it is this knowledge that would have been handed down to me in her genes. I could have done with some of them and that know-how about a fortnight ago, when what started out as a typical day...
Morning, Mr. Stationmaster. No sign of the 8:15 commuter special, although it clearly says 8:15 on your timetable. Is there a reason for this, or is it some game where the train that gets closest to this time wins a prize?
Sir, you are a wag. But if you see anything even resembling a train, please give me a nod. It's so long since I've seen one, I've forgotten what they look like. And now, if you'll excuse me...
I got in early. I could tell the cleaning ladies had been hard at work. My seat was still warm and a lot of my paperwork had been corrected.
What on earth is Mr. Bristow flailing his arms about for? Desk rage?
In a way, he's going through his drowning man routine. He claims every time he sits down at his desk, his whole past life flashes before him.
Mr. Bristow!
Heavens alive, boy. You startled me.
Postcard from the cleaning lady. Shall I read it out?
Why not?
Lovely weather, beautiful sunny morning. Stayed in, dusted the room, swept the floor, washed the linoleum, scrubbed the bath, disinfected the toilet, having a lovely time.
Bears out what I've always said. A change is as good as a rest.
What a life. As we left the office on Friday, it started to rain, and it rained right through the weekend and all the way here this morning. Then, as we came into the building, the rain stopped. And look at it out there now. 9 to 5 sunshine.
Jones! Why do we stick at this job?
Oh, wages. That's why we stick at this job, because they pay us wages.
But there's more to life than this. There's a world out there waiting to be conquered.
It don't beat wages. You can't beat wages.
But what of excitement, ambition and adventure?
Oh, wages is all them things and much, much, much more.
Oh. Morning, Mr. Fudge.
Morning, Fudge. Morning, sir.
Ignorant pig. Friday lunchtime, he passed me in the street, didn't say a word. I said, good afternoon. He ignored me completely. I'd have run after him and given him a piece of my mind if I'd been foraging through a dustbin at the time.
Good morning, all. Isn't it exciting?
Good morning, Miss Summon. I know something is exciting because the girls in the typing pool have all polished the rings on the ends of their noses. But I'm not acquainted with the reason.
Sir Reginald Chester Perry, the firm's founder, is in the building.
Exciting, Miss Summon? Why should it be exciting because our beloved firm's founder has come in to play with his toys?
It may not be exciting to you, but the girls in the typing pool have never seen him in the flesh. Have you?
No. Jones has, haven't you, Jones?
Haven't I what?
Seen Sir Reginald Chester Perry.
Yes. Bumped into him in the corridor. Sent him flying.
How did he take it?
Picture, if you can, two clear blue eyes filled with compassion and understanding.
Hold on, Jones. Do you consider yourself some sort of authority on people's expressions?
As a matter of fact, I do.
How would you describe this expression?
That is a mixture of loathing and contempt.
He's very good. Yep, but enough of this. The question we must ask ourselves is this. Why has Sir Reginald Chester Perry, our beloved firm's founder, chosen this particular day to grace us with his presence?
Oh, look at his car out there. That beautiful white Rolls with the black leather upholstery. When are you going to get one of those?
Payday.
But he's silly to come into town in a car with traffic warden 262 on the rampage. He's always getting parking tickets.
Look at the number of tickets she's handed out this morning. Every car in the street. Practically a rainforest out there.
Surely a parking ticket is nothing to a multimillionaire.
And that's where you're wrong, Miss Sutton. People with money are reputedly mean.
And none more so than our beloved firm's founder, who bought his helicopter simply to scour the countryside in the mornings looking for latecomers. The question we are asking, Miss Sunman, is why our beloved firm's founder should suddenly deign to call on us. And we shall have the answer in any second. Here comes the lift boy. I say...
Hello, Mr. B. What can I do for you?
Why is Sir Reginald Chester Perry here?
What's in it for me?
Don't waste time, boy. Jones, give him a quick Chinese burn.
No need for that. The directors are in. I took a crowd up to the boardroom. It's an emergency meeting. The Chester Perry Company are making a takeover bid for Miles and Rudge, the firm across the street.
It was at that moment that a shudder went through me. It might have been that I caught my elbow on the edge of the filing cabinet, but I'd rather believe it was one of my mother's ancestors' genes pricking its ears up at the mention of the word takeover. Springing into action like one of my great-great-great-grandfather's forebears sighting a castle wall, I took over the situation. Thank you, lad. On your way.
Take it easy, will you?
Miss Sullen, the conversation you just heard is confidential.
You mean about the takeover?
Shh. Walls have ears.
Careless talk costs lives.
Jones.
Sorry.
Why has it got to be kept secret?
If news of this leaked out, it would cause a sensation on the stock exchange. Stocks and shares, etc., etc. Panic buying and so on. Confusion, chaos, bulls and bears.
Dow Jones index down, FTSE up. Hang Seng, something.
Jones, I shan't tell you again. You are now frightening, Miss Sunderland.
I wouldn't say frightened. I don't know what you're talking about, that's all.
Quite so, men's talk. You run along, my dear. But remember, mum's the word.
Bye.
I've been thinking, Jones. If we knew anything about the stock market, we ought to be able to make some money out of this. I mean, we know that our company are going to try and take over another company, and we know this. And if we bought shares in that company, or this company, we could tell a broker this, and he could invest and gain heavily.
You are talking about... what is it? We have information. We ought to invest in the company that is taking over... No. The company that is being taken, or is it the company that's, which is us, of course, the buyer, the broker buys the shares and sells them to us, and we buy them, and everyone makes a killing. That's what we're talking about, right?
It's brilliant, Jones. We are sitting on a fortune, but we must keep it to ourselves and not go around telling everyone. I know you and your loose tongue. Now, how do we go about getting some advice? Of course, the answer to our prayers.
I'll say, nothing like a nice cup of tea and a chocolate bun to start the day.
Jones, I'm not talking about tea and buns. I am referring to what we were talking about.
The stocks and shares thing. Look at the cream puffs.
Stocks and shares? You want to know about investment? You want a portfolio together? You have a good tip? You want a broker?
Don't keep touching them, Jones, unless you're going to buy. You're spreading germs all over the place. I don't know where you were brought up. But they must have told you about hygiene.
I'll have the eclair, the macaroon, the custard tart and the donut.
Steady, Jones. Don't go spending it before you've earned it.
And don't tell me what to do with my money.
Gentlemen, please behave yourselves.
Well...
I'm afraid you can't take all those, Mr. Jones. Otherwise there won't be any left for anyone else.
It's not my fault. She put more cakes on the trolley.
There's no room.
Nonsense. Assuming the surface area of a macaroon is 3¼ centimetres...
Hello? What's this in your waste paper basket, Mr. Bristow? Why, it's yesterday's light as a feather fairy cake. It must have fallen off your desk.
Fallen off nothing. It was pushed. Jones, we have to talk. Thank you, Mrs. Purdy. Bye. Did you get anything from what she said?
Not really.
I didn't think you did. But I wish you would pay more attention.
Mm-hmm.
If we're going to make a killing out of this, we have to listen and absorb everything that we are told.
Right.
Some people have to go to evening classes and all that to learn what we can learn in a few hours. Uh-huh. I mean, we are at the center of the operation. It is all happening around us. It was good in a way that we didn't show too much interest in what Mrs. Purdy was saying.
Right.
And alert anyone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.